I call this meeting of the United County Board of County Commissioners to order for NHRMC public hearing on October 15th. This public hearing is being recorded and streamed live on our Facebook page. For anyone who's unable to attend tonight, each person will be able to speak for up to 3 minutes. There's a timekeeper next to the podium who will let you know when you have 1 minute left and then when your time is up. Please be courteous and end your comments at 3 minutes, and that goes for everyone. We ask that you speak about your priorities for health care in our community, what is important to you and your family, and what you feel should be required as part of the request for proposals that will be developed. We have members of our hospital board of trustees as well as our partnership advisory group here tonight. The advisory group will be working over the coming months to develop the request for proposals, and the information heard tonight will help inform that work. So that everyone is aware, once the request for proposal has been developed, it will be shared with the public, the trustees and commissioners. This is anticipated to occur no earlier than December, after the advisory group puts in a lot of work into its development, as well as gains an understanding of the full scope of NHRMC's current position and the industry as a whole. We anticipate allowing 60 days for organizations to respond, so it will likely be in February or March before proposals are received. At that time, they will be shared publicly, and we will convene another public hearing to receive comments on the proposals. It is important to note that while the RFP is out, the Partnership Advisory Group will be also examining the options for maintaining county ownership and will then be able to take that research and evaluate the proposals that come. Now let's get started. I will call several people at a time based on the sign-up sheet. Please come up in the order you're called to the podium, state your name and your address for the public record. Please talk directly into the microphone, no more than 2 inches away from your mouth for our hard of hearing attendees. And one note, tonight I ask that you refrain from any derogatory remarks about me or my board members. We really want you to state your concerns in regards to the question at hand. And with that being said, we'll call our first three individuals to the microphone: Jason Thompson, Jerome Fennell, and Barbara Boehner.
Jason, is it on?
There we go. Now it's on. I'll start over. Don't hold that against my time. Matter of fact, wait 30 seconds and start because I'm slow. It went off again. Do we have IT?
I think we're having some technical microphone.
No problem. Okay, I think we got it. All right, so Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, thank you for having us here tonight. I have some comments prepared. Since there's no podium, I'm just gonna hold them very unprofessionally here and read them to you. As the incoming chairman of the New Hanover Regional Medical Center's Board of Trustees, I would like to affirm our board, that being the Board of Trustees' commitment to the process of evaluating what steps should be taken to ensure the best possible future for our hospital and our citizens of this community. The Board of Trustees has 17 members, the majority appointed by you, our county commissioners, with additional representation from the New Hanover Regional Medical Center medical staff and Pender County. Our members come with diverse backgrounds, interests, and expertise. We share a commitment to serving this community and doing what's right to advance the region's healthcare. We take time to learn, understand the healthcare landscape, and work with hospital leaders to help chart the strategic direction of the organization. Through this work, we have seen the tremendous opportunity that exists to improve access, value, and health equity while improving the quality of care and supporting our tremendous team of employees and medical staff. We've also seen some challenges and know that to succeed, We must evolve and be open to new ideas. Here are just a few of the challenges that we as a community and a hospital face. North Carolina Medicaid program's new fixed cost model will cut reimbursements to NHRMC by between $13 and $16 million every year. Medicare is moving to a similar model, and private employers and insurers will not be willing to cover that shifting cost. Changes in the 340B drug policy. That policy helps pay for medication for those who cannot afford what they need, could cost NHRMC $30 million annually. A minute, I'm not even close. Changes in our statute as a sole community hospital could cost at least $30 million. We have funding capital project needs of over $1 billion in our 10-year strategic plan. In fulfillment of our roles as trustees, we will be actively involved in working with and alongside the Partnership Advisory Group to define priorities for the future, review proposals received, and articulate our assessment of whether any of the proposed options can help New Hanover Regional Medical Center achieve our goals and vision for the future more quickly and effectively than it could without doing anything at all. It is our intent to have 5 members of our board work as members of the PAG, and those members have already been appointed. As you know, we're all here today. To ensure the full board's timely involvement and to make sure we do not hinder the process, the Board of Trustees will now meet every month instead of every other month during the remainder of this process. Thank you for your time.
Oh, you cut me off right on the thing.
Jerome Fennell, you can state your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Jerome Fennell. I'm sorry, if you said address.
We need to figure out the microphone, folks.
Chairman, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Good. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you for allowing me to come here tonight.
And we're going to need you to speak up, Mr.
Okay.
Fennell.
Planning for the future generally takes some assuming based on what you know about the present and understanding about what is likely to change. As a member of the Board of Trustees of New Hanover Regional Medical Center, I have come to understand that nearly everything is likely to change and how the business.
We're working on another microphone for you.
Thank you.
He needs an additional 10 minutes now.
It's time for you to sit down, Chairman.
You can start over.
Start over?
Yes.
Planning for the future generally takes making some assumptions based on what you know about the present and understanding about what is likely to change. As a member of the Board of Trustees of New Hanover Regional Medical Center, I have come to understand that nearly everything is likely to change and how the business of healthcare operates. However, the most important thing will not change. That is our focus on providing excellent care. With that in mind, NHRMC leaders and board members began work on a strategic plan a few years ago that sets the directions for our health system going forward. Those include improving access to care and wellness through more customer-centric options, advancing the value of the care we provide through high quality and lower costs to not only treat the sick, but keep them well, achieving health equity through community partnerships and activities that remove barriers to care, supporting our staff and the culture that has made our center one of the top places to work in the country, partnering with providers, the doctors, to make Southeastern North Carolina an excellent place to practice medicine so we can continue to attract top talent and compassionate professionals. Growing the level of scope of care already in place for all so that no one is denied treatment because they can't pay for it. Investing to ensure the long-term financial security and future of our health system. We believe these priorities are vital to the future of our business. We are looking forward to the opportunity to learn more about our options. We are fortunate to be in the position we are in. We have a strong healthcare system that is respected for its quality of care and compassionate teams, and its position to get better. The possibility of moving forward will likely be wide. We will have a lot to evaluate, weighing the pros and cons of each proposal. We recognize the great opportunity and obligation to get this right. I encourage every member of our community to take the time to really understand the questions and options we will be exploring in the coming months. At this point, no one...
Mr. Fennell, you're out of time. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next is Ms. Barbara Bainer. If you state your name and address for the record, please.
Yes, sir. Barbara Bainer, 101 Buckeye Drive, Wilmington. Glad to be here. I'm here as a resident for almost 14 years. I've been on the board of New Hanover Regional Medical Center for 3, and I also have been a healthcare leader for the past 35 years. So I'm pleased to come here and talk to you about the challenges we're facing. I'd like to speak about the industry factors that I see driving the exploration for the best course of our future. First and foremost is the change that has been evolving since the Affordable Care Act, which actually came about in 2009. You may know it as Obamacare, you may know it as the Affordable Care or Accountable Care Act, a lot of different names for it. We're moving away from fee-for-service and getting paid for the services we provide to a value model in which the service provider is paid a standard rate regardless of what it takes to take care of the patient and the individual needs and how different they may be. While this value model has benefits, such as supporting holistic care, and holding down spending, it also carries more risk. Because if you have too many people with highly complicated and costly conditions in your pool of individuals that you're representing, you may not be able to cover the overall cost of care that's needed. The important thing for us to remember is as our city and our region grows, we're growing with a lot of the retirement community that are coming here. And it's important to note that those over the age of 55 actually take up over half of the healthcare spend. And that's what we're facing as we move forward. To succeed in this model, hospitals need to make the changes to be ready while simultaneously working within the current system. And it takes significant investments, as Jerome was mentioning, in these new services, people, and technology. Throughout the state and really throughout the country, we're seeing providers work together to share the resources to become more effective and manage the health of their patients and their communities more cost-effectively. Not just their health care, but their health. As a relatively small independent healthcare system, New Hanover Regional doesn't have access to capital that is required to make this shift while also serving the rapidly growing community and the needs of our booming population. Which is why this process is so important to us. Through it, we will better understand our options for improving healthcare and keeping pace with our growing community. We'll be looking for the best way to secure our future, recognizing that success here is not about profit. It's not about access to cash. It's about people, our people. We need to make sure they have the best possible care to keep them well and to be there when they need us the most. I'm honored to be a part of this process and appreciate the opportunity we've been given. I look forward to working with fellow board members, county commissioners, the others on the advisory group, to focus on what's important and to make the right decision about the health and well-being of our region. Thank you.
Thank you. Next will be Susan Bondurant, Pamela Waite, and Henry Westreich. If you'd come and state your name and address for the record, please.
Excuse me. My name is Susan Bondurant. I'm a citizen, and I mainly came here tonight to listen this afternoon and to congratulate the county commissioners on embracing transparency on this very important move for our region, our county, our city. The fact that you have decided to have a 21-member committee, people from varied backgrounds, people who are knowledgeable about this situation, and the fact that you made the initial hearing one where people who are almost deaf like me can hear, thank you, and that you have made the initial hearing of the proper length, 3 hours. This is a very, very important thing that we're doing. It needs the time. We need to take the time. We need to educate ourselves. And I am only hoping that as this year or more goes by, where we all delve into the details, where we find out what other communities have done, where we find the downsides and the upsides, that you will continue to make hearings be of this length. Not 1 hour. 3 hours is wonderful. And as we gain more knowledge, those of us who are not experts like myself, I read as much as I can, but as we gain more knowledge as we go along, we're going to need more time, more hearings, and it pleased me so to hear that the trustees at the hospital are going to have a meeting every month instead of every other month. We have to give this subject the attention it deserves. Stop watching TV, don't watch so many football games, and really try to help our community come out on the up end of this, and thank you very much.
Pamela Waite.
My name is Pamela Waite. There we go. My name is Pamela Waite. I reside at 503 Glasgow Drive in Wilmington. I am a market researcher for the healthcare industry. As a researcher, I actually read every single one of your biographies. So, and I couldn't help but notice the depth and breadth of talent among this group. But one of the things that I noticed was that the business concerns of those in the medical community outside of New Hanover Medical Center are not represented here on your board. We know that very talented physicians and other healthcare providers do an excellent job in this community. I've been the recipient of that healthcare. But it only works if the organizational and business portions of the practices are in favorable and stable situations. I think that these independent medical groups, and give you an example, the CEO of Emerge Ortho, the CEO of Wilmington Health, I was surprised not to find those voices in your group. I'm pleased to see that there is a geriatrician on your group, however. Yes, and I recognize you, because that is where the costs are coming up. And the other thing that I'd like to see in an RFP and the responses you get, I'd very much like to see concrete suggestions. We've talked about increased care and quality and access at lower cost, but you previous speakers have already outlined things like the 340B issue. I'd like to see specifics out as to how someone can do it better than Mr. Gidzik can already. A talented man, and I don't see why you can't bring it forward. So specifics, concrete things that we can actually examine, not simply theoretical concerns. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Henry Westrich. I am 40 years a hospital administrator in New York and New Jersey. I did everything from dealing with Nobel Prize winners to working in the prison system. I've been there and seen everything. And one of the things that amazes me is back when I first started, we were told that healthcare was going to die because Medicare was coming in. It was the end of the world. It was communism and socialism. And that was when you still had a $5 office visit. And now you have a $200 cold with the x-ray and all the other tests. But I think it's time to get to reality, folks. It's all nice and good about everything you're talking. I have questions about how you hired Navigant, a consultant that nobody knew about till later. I have a document here, New York Times, about Navigant's incompetence. I wonder if anyone's ever done this. We had Navigant when I was in New York City Health and Hospitals. They charged us $2 million for consultants for one day a week, and they didn't show up one day a week. Made the Times the day before I had a meeting set with them. I wonder what the process is, whether you have to go out for bids. I don't know. Is there a county process, a hospital process, a state process? But something is wrong. There's more than one firm out there. And if you get involved in some sort of restructuring, you're going to need trustworthy accountants, lawyers, consultants. I don't know how you're going to find them if you keep on using the same ones over and over. I have 58 seconds, fine. I still want to know what the end game is. I'm a little skeptical about all of this. Like I said, I worked in New York. There is an end game, and I don't know what it is. What does this group want to do with healthcare? Because you do a pretty good job, but you got to thank your demographics for that. If you were working in an environment where I work with 400,000 uninsured patients, then you wouldn't be doing it. Think about that. You lucked out with the patients you got and the senior citizens. That's really about it. And truthfully, there is no transparency. You have hardly any senior citizens. You have no real people here, working people, retired people. I'm done. Thank you.
The next three will be Buckle Shields, Neil Shulman, and DeAndre Corniff. You can please state your name and address for the record, please.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight to speak, and I'm a little disappointed in this $85 million building that nobody could locate a lectern so you could put your notes on them to read them. But anyway, for those who don't know me, I'm a former county commissioner. I served from 1974 through 1986. And in that period of time, I appointed quite a few members to the Hospital Board of Trustees. My concern right now with the action that's being taken is a matter of transparency. And the reason I say this is that I don't know how many of y'all were at the meeting at the Northeast Library, but there was a committee appointed in 1997 to look at the restructuring of New Hanover Memorial Hospital. I chaired that committee along with 13 other people. We were given directions, and it appeared at that time that we were being steered in a certain direction. So we backed up and said, if you're telling us where we're going, we're not going to do it. The bottom line was we met two times with the county commissioners. We met weekly as a committee. When it came time to make the presentation to the county, we had two meetings with them. There was never a final report allowed to be filed on our recommendations. The only way you can find out what happened in those minutes, in those meetings, is to go to the record books and look up the minutes there in book 25, page 938 for the 2 minutes. And this is why I feel I'm concerned about the transparency, is the fact that the commissioners adopted a resolution with intent to sell. In my humble opinion, something else could have been done instead of that. To me, that means that a majority of the board has agreed that that's what they want to do. And I'm opposed to the sale, but I'm in favor of looking at what we can do as a community to improve the services of New Hanover Regional Medical Center to the community and to make it a more viable and functional unit. Thank you.
Hello, Jason.
Man, long time no see.
My name is Neil Shulman. I live at 119 Nash Drive. I am not in favor of the sale, and I'd like to make the following comments. At the first meeting, I listened to everyone on the podium saying, we can't do anything unless we have this resolution. Then we find out, oh, that's not exactly true. We've had meetings, we've spent money. Oh, we're not breaking the law, though. Deception is deception, people. The voters are the ones, the taxpayers are the ones that own this facility, not you. And as such, we should be the ones who decide what to do. The other thing I wonder about is, how come all these other hospitals are having this problem? Have you talked to any of them? Have any of them come forward? Have you joined any together and say, what are we going to do since this is going to be a statewide problem? I haven't heard of anything. And if we're being told all these different things, how are we supposed to trust this process? I don't think it's transparent. I don't think anybody else does. Maybe we ought to start thinking about the public, the taxpayers, the voters, the people who put you there. Because this is our facility. This is our medical benefits, not yours. Thank you.
Give me 5 minutes. Hi, my name is DeAndre Corniff. I live at 113 Henry Street. I was born and raised in Wilmington, North Carolina. And one of the things that I learned as I grew up in Wilmington is that Southerners, we are polite, just out of habit. When you go to New Hanover Regional Medical Center, you get good hospitality. And if you weren't visiting someone or checking in yourself,
excuse me 1 second. Madam Reporter in the back, that's in the middle of the aisle, if you could please keep your comments low. Thank you.
You can restart the clock. If you weren't checking in to New Hanover Regional Medical Center or visiting someone in the hospital, you would think you were checking into a hotel because the hospitality is so good. But one of the things that this commission, and I want to thank you guys for the work you've done, Chairman and fellow commissioners, and giving me this opportunity to speak. One of the things that you neglected to do in this process was the same thing that a landlord, owner of a property would do for his tenants. Before he put a for sale sign out in front of the building, he would have a conversation with his tenants. And that wasn't done in this process. There are two things that need to be addressed. There could be a non-binding resolution presented by the commission. It doesn't have to be a referendum, rather. It doesn't have to be put on the ballot by a bunch of signatures from the citizens. This commission could have a referendum so that the citizens can decide whether or not they would like to have a subsidy imposed through taxes. And because New Hanover County Regional Medical Center is a regional hospital, I understand that we represent, or the hospital serves over 7 counties, including New Hanover. And those counties should also have the option of a referendum to decide on whether or not they wanted to participate in a subsidy. And our Board of Trustees can definitely get the numbers for what that subsidy might look like. If it was just in New Hanover County, if the other counties didn't want to participate, or if that subsidy could be spread out among the 7 counties total. And we need to know what costs New Hanover County Regional Medical Center is expecting in the future so that we could decide whether or not the citizens can afford a tax that would be the subsidy to keep the hospital as it is before we go to having the hospital be purchased and money taken out of the hospital for profits. Thank you.
Next will be William Shell, Catherine Walker, and Esther Murphy. You can state your name and address for the record, please.
William Shell, I live at 408 Sundial Court. I've spoken with you before. I'm not going to be long. I'm going to cover 3 short items. In all these meetings that I've been to, the most important factor for everyone practically that's spoken, is to maintain local control. So whatever comes out of this, the people are looking to maintain local control. Once that local control is lost, it is lost. It will not come back. This hospital has prospered with local control, and that's the way it usually needs to stay. Number 2 is that the overwhelming problem with healthcare in America is its cost. It costs too much. It just does. We're so far ahead and so much more expensive than any other place in the world. Every business school, every think tank study has shown that medical care consolidation raises cost, reduces services, and there are no economies of scale. So that's an issue that needs to be addressed, whatever happens in this situation. The third one is kind of personal to me, and I haven't really seen it mentioned before. It's becoming increasingly concerning to me, though. I've had heart surgery here, and I've had neurosurgery here. Where you see these consolidations across the country, you then begin to see the entity which controls it moving those services to someplace else because they're profitable and they want them to be in some other place. And those run the risk here of our citizens when they have to have those complex matters done, such as heart surgery, which is profitable, neurosurgery, those will go someplace else under the umbrella of a much bigger organization. I ask you to take all of those into consideration because I think all of those are extremely important and they really form the gist of the reason that I oppose the sale of this hospital or the combination with a bigger organization outside this area. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is... Good afternoon. My name is Catherine Walker, and I live at 902 Shelton Court here in Wilmington. I am a new resident here in Wilmington, having just moved here a year ago. I am a retired nurse. I have worked for nonprofit and for-profit hospitals and healthcare organizations. This is the first time I've come to a meeting like this, so right now I have one question for all of you, both your hospital board and you ladies and gentlemen on the stage. why would you ever consider turning over a monopoly, which is what New Hanover Regional Medical Center is, turn over a monopoly to a for-profit company? Thank you.
Hello, my name is Esther Murphy. I live at 7235 Darden Road. I am a citizen of Wilmington, and I'm here. I really didn't prepare to speak because I thought we were going to have standing room only, but I feel that these empty seats represent everyone that is working so hard to live here with this cost of living, that I have to represent those who don't have the time or the wherewithal. This hospital affects me personally. The history, the mission, it's the presence, the entity. I've even been a volunteer at New Hanover. We have a gem. We have something that is outstanding in this country. And I feel that it has to be taken out because we've proven how successful a publicly owned hospital can be. I am insulted and offended by the way the process has been going. I've been to all the public forums, and I'm trying to follow the private invitation-only events, or what little access I can get to that. I have had the administrator of PR and public relations refer to people who are against this sale as scared, ignorant, parochial, and paranoid. I am none of that. And the people that we have that are telling you that this is a really bad idea are far more experienced than anybody involved in making this decision. I'm assaulted and I'm offended. I feel that the public representation from the county has cut off communications. She's a personal friend of mine, has not returned my calls to try to explain this process. I don't like the way this thing's going. And I also find that the vision is incredibly narrow and frankly dangerous, very small, short-sighted, and insulting. We can do so much better. I'll tell you, when this hospital changed from being a nonprofit to a not-for-profit, when the report was not delivered to the county commissioners, and the name was changed from Memorial Hospital to Regional, which assumed that eventually they would change the way that the money could be dispersed, but it didn't actually happen that way. I was working four jobs and ways in my family, and I couldn't come and stand up to this, but it was dirty then. It put this hospital on a trajectory that we're facing now, and the people behind it do not have the best interest of the average working middle class people in this town. And we're onto it, and we don't feel like there's anything we can do about it. Keep this hospital public and look for a bigger vision. There's so much better we can do. Thank you.
And the next three will be Dale Smith, Joan Donahue, and Jeff James. Please state your name and address for the record.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dale Smith. As many of you know, I've been a resident of Wilmington at 816 Bedminster Lane. I've actually been a resident here for about 25 years and pretty active in the community. But I'm here to talk about a factor that I haven't heard mentioned yet, because my background is as a corporate owner, as an executive vice president of a multi-billion dollar company responsible for 30,000 employees. I went through a lot of mergers and acquisitions in my time as an executive, and very rarely did the employees get the consideration that they should receive. So my advice, if you're going to proceed with this process, is that maximum amount of consideration is given to the employees, their benefits, and their future. Most of you would say, if you were asked, I would hope, that your most valuable asset with the hospital are the employees. and yet they don't get the kind of consideration they should get in a merger and acquisition. And not just, it's not just a personal thing or their value, it's a cost thing. I can guarantee you this process is already costing you money in terms of the loss of productivity of your employees. I recently had a, just a small example, and I'm sure it happens hundreds of times a day, I recently had a small procedure there, and much of the conversation I had with the doctors and nurses had to do with this process, and I didn't initiate it. So you're losing time right now. One of the most valuable things in addition to the employees is your reputation. Your reputation is stellar. And if you lose that reputation among the community and among your employees, you're going to lose employees, which you're already bound to do because of the process. Your safety problems are going to go up. And so you really need to pay attention to this issue. You're going to have more difficulty recruiting people. The reputation you have is based on this entity as it is with this name. When you become a part of a larger organization, your reputation will not only be based on this entity, but on the reputation of that larger organization, and may be a problem for you to recruit people and retain employees. So again, please pay attention to the employees in this process and their value to this organization. Thank you.
Good afternoon, beg your pardon. My name is Joanne Donahue. My address is 2129 Zimmerman Way in Leland. A couple of things. I'm now retired, but I spent 15 years as a healthcare executive, 10 of them in a hospital. So I have a little background, and I was around when the Clinton administration was looking to change the healthcare system top to toe. We never quite know how it's going to go. We know there will be change, but we don't know its shape. So I'm very sympathetic to the challenge that the Regional Medical Center is looking at. That said, I think it's premature to consider a sale, but not premature to consider partnerships. One thing I would like to really focus attention on is that whatever shape the changes will take, it seems like the one thing that will be central will be how the finances are tied to the health outcomes. We have gone over a period of time from a straight up cost plus system to fee for service, and we are moving in the direction of capitated care, a sum of money per head. What that's going to mean is that the winners and losers in the future are going to be those that will be able to have a clear understanding of the costs of healthcare linked to the health outcomes. Right now, what we have is billing systems, and they do not answer that question. So one thing we need to think carefully about is, as we look for partners in the future, going to larger partners doesn't necessarily address that issue. You get folks that have larger billing systems. I would really encourage you to think hard about partnering with information system entrepreneurs who are looking specifically at this issue. And when they look at it, they're going to be looking in a more broad area than what takes place within institutions. They're going to be looking at what happens at home. You know, we're going to need to look at how the top diagnoses for certain types of care suck down a lot of health resources. Think of asthma and what that costs in going to the emergency room. The folks who come up with this kind of information system are going to be looking at what happens at home, what kind of environmental exposures will end up with a child in the emergency room. So I strongly encourage you to look at healthcare information systems that are going to help predict what the costs are and the best outcomes. This regional medical center starts from a strong position, financially healthy, very good outcomes, and one other thing I would like you to consider. I'm in Brunswick County. I know that this is a regional medical center, and yet the expenses all land in New Hanover County. I don't love paying taxes any more than anybody else, but since I'm a participant in health care, I'm willing to pay it through taxes.
May I leave written comments with you?
You can leave those with our clerk to my right here. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Chairman Barfield. My name is Jeff James. I'm the CEO of Wilmington Health. Thank you for holding this hearing, and thank you for allowing all of us to be here. Can I scoot it up a little bit? Good? Good, good. Okay. Let me start off by saying this community is very fortunate. In my 25 years of healthcare executive experience, I have never seen a medical community of this size with so much capability and so much potential to positively impact the entire delivery system for the better. Without question, the physician corps in this community is the best I've ever seen anywhere. And the hospital is second to none. We congratulate the hospital on its achievements, its commitment to the community, and recognize their goal is to do the best for the community. The community is fortunate to have an asset like New Hanover Regional Medical Center, and we have every confidence in their leadership. I think it is important to say that neither Wilmington Health nor I have formed an opinion and do not currently support any position or have any recommendations on the proper course of action for the county commissioners as it relates to a possible transaction involving the community's asset. It is clearly in the community and Wilmington Health's best interest to have a strong hospital. We do, however, have questions and concerns. The first is about this process. There is no representation of independent group practices in this process. It is fair to say that the NHRMC physician group is well represented by the hospital leadership and the members of the Board of Trustees, and the hospital medical staff is well represented by the five physicians appointed to the PAG by the Medical Executive Committee. However, it does not appear that the independent practice organizations have been asked to participate in this process in any meaningful way. Speaking for Wilmington Health, as the second largest purveyor of physician services in the county and one of the largest independent and most successful multi-specialty group practices in the state, we have yet to be engaged in the dialogue. This is despite several attempts on our part to engage constructively in the process. While we have tremendous respect for the physicians, named to the PAG by the Medical Executive Committee and applaud their willingness to serve in what will certainly be a challenging position, in no way do they represent or nor do they have any authorization to speak on behalf of Wilmington Health. There's a question in our minds as to whether there is truly representation for any particular constituency or even the community as a whole. Here's why. It is our understanding, as part of this process, the members of the PAG will be required to sign confidentiality agreements. The very nature of confidentiality agreements limits dialogue, and without dialogue between representatives and his or her constituency, there can be no true representation. One question we have is, will the nature of these confidentiality agreements be made public? Will the public get a chance to understand what their representatives can and can't talk about?
Mr. James, your time is up. Thank you, sir. The next two on our list are Kathy Muzzy and David Ward.
I'm Kathy Muzzy, and I'm going to pass my time as my concerns have already been eloquently expressed.
Mr. Ward?
Yes, I'm a lifetimer in this county. Been here all my life. My father helped build that hospital from the ground up. My wife worked at that hospital. Now, my father, working in this county, we built a lot of things in this county, and we've seen it grown from a very small county in population grown up. We've seen a lot of buildings come up in this county. And one thing to be very proud of is this hospital, because it came up with the people paying for it. We voted to build this hospital. It's come up and it's grown very large. It's prospered, it's still prospering. When we sell a property, we own many properties in this county. When we sell a property, there's got to be a motivation for me to want to sell one. Either it's going to be make a profit, or it's going to do me some good. What is the motivation for this? That's what we need to ask ourselves. What is the motivation? Once you sell it,
The money's gone. If I sell a house, and unless I'm gonna invest that in something else that's gonna make more money, that's gonna do me some good and keep making me money, that money's gone. Once you sell this hospital, the money's gonna go quickly. And I will challenge you to try to build that hospital back for $1 billion. Cape Fear Hospital, New Hanover Hospital, all those campuses, all those buildings, you'll never do it. Never in your lifetime would you ever do it. You can't build it back. Right now, we're prospering. This county is doing well. The hospital's doing real well. You say in your news release that if you sell it, you could put the money in the bank, it would do the county good. Well, I say that you already have money in the bank because you own it. We, the people, own it. We pay for it. Now you've gone to a regional hospital and you let everybody enjoy it, and that's great. It probably went through a state process to do that so that Brunswick and everybody in the area can enjoy this hospital. So I say that if you're going to do something, you need to include everybody in the area, and you need to have a vote. We, the people, need a say-so in this because we know that it benefits us. Just like the gentleman said, once you lose control of it, who knows what that new owner is going to do to it? Who knows what's going to happen? You have right now control. You know what's going to happen. You can control what's going on there. Once we lose control, what's going to happen to the people that do not have insurance, want to come in there and get some health care? Out the door you go, buddy. You don't have any insurance. Goodbye. You can't come in here. What's going to happen to the prices that are being charged at that hospital? We have no say-so any further. Right now, you have money in the bank. What is it going to help to sell it?
Ask, Mr. Ward, you've come to the end of your time.
We'll answer that. What's it going to do to sell it?
We've now come to the end of the list of those that are signed to speak up. If there are others that would like to speak, you can stop in the lobby, see our deputy clerk to the board. There's a sign-in sheet there for those that may want to speak. This is a public hearing. It's being recorded and streamed live on our Facebook page for anyone who is unable to attend. Each person will be able to speak for 3 minutes. There's a timekeeper next to the podium who will let you know when you have 1 minute left and then when your time is up. Please be courteous and end your comments at 3 minutes. We ask that you speak about your priorities for health care in our community. What is important to you and your family? And what do you feel should be required as part of the request for proposals that will be developed? We have members of our hospital board of trustees as well as our partnership advisory group here tonight. The advisory group will be working over the coming months to develop the request for proposals, and the information heard tonight will be help inform that work. So that everyone is aware, once a request for proposal has been developed, it will be shared with the public, the trustees, and commissioners. This is anticipated to occur no earlier than December, after the advisory group puts in a lot of work into its development, as well as gains an understanding of the full scope of NHRMC's current position and the industry as a whole. We anticipate allowing 60 days for organizations to respond, so it will likely be in February or March before proposals are received. At that time, they'll be shared publicly and we'll convene another public hearing to receive comments on the proposals. It is important to note that while the RFP is out, the Partnership Advisory Group will also be examining the options for maintaining county ownership and will then be able to take that research and evaluate the proposals that come. Please, for those that want to speak, talk directly into the microphone, no more than 2 inches away from your face, so that our hard of hearing attendees can indeed hear. And with that, we have no one else signed up to speak. And we have two more. Chastity Case and Chris Bunch. If you can state your name and address for the record, please.
Chastity Chase, 4411 Addenbury Court, Wilmington, North. Chastity Chase, 4411 Addenbury Court, Wilmington, North Carolina. I'm the Chief Financial Officer for Wilmington Health. Of most concern to us is the near certainty that a sale will increase the cost of care and could potentially reduce the quality of care in the community. It is not reasonable to assume that an organization is going to invest close to $1 billion and not expect a return on their investment. The claims that the investment will be recouped through efficiency and growth of patient volumes across a region is disingenuous at best. A simple Google search using the term, quote, impact of hospital consolidation on medical cost reveals the following top six results. The impact of hospital consolidation on medical cost in CCI increase 6 to 18%. Bigger but not better, hospital mergers increase cost and do not improve quality. Hospital mergers often raise prices, analysis finds. Provider consolidation drives up healthcare cost. MedPAC to explore if hospital consolidation impacts Medicare cost. When hospitals merge to save money, patients often pay more. On September 16th, a representative from one of the potential RFP recipients reached out to Wilmington Health to get a feel on our perspective. When asked about the cost of care going up, his response was very simple. Quote, you are right to be concerned about the cost of care. Anyone, including us who purchase it, will be looking for a return. We told him we appreciated his honesty at a minimum. It is highly likely we will see dollars leave the community, jobs leave or never materialize in the community, and New Hanover and county employers and our patients will be footing the bill. Make no mistake, this is a form of tax. It just comes without representation. As one of the area's largest employers, we have seen firsthand what can happen to the cost of care when a large health system is brought into our community. Many of the physicians in the New Hanover Regional Medical Center Physician Group are actually employed by Charlotte-based Atrium Health already. Atrium was formerly Carolina's healthcare system and one of the likely suitors to buy the hospital. The prior hospital administration cut this deal, and the cost to our self-funded plan went up overnight, as it did for every other employer self-funded plan in the community, including the one you are responsible for. As more and more physicians were acquired by Atrium under the guise of NHRMC, our health plan costs continue to increase. As a self-funded payer, we have access to the detailed claim information. Double-digit percentage increases could be seen in our claims literally overnight. Nothing changed about the provider or the service, except one day they were a community provider and the next they were employed by a larger system from Charlotte. To add insult to injury, millions and millions of dollars leave the community in the form of management fees to this large system year after year. Thank you.
My name is Chris Bunch and I live at 5500 Woodland Trace. I'm the Chief Operating Officer of Wilmington Health. Finally, a consultant firm has been hired to develop a strategy around selling the hospital. A PR firm was engaged weeks ahead of any formal announcement to help craft the message to the public. I'm guessing the phrase "we're just asking the question" was coined by this PR firm. We're confident the county commissioners will be provided an excellent alternative for sale or other transaction. One of our major remaining questions is when we will see an equal amount of effort, perhaps a different consultant firm, a different advisory group, or anyone engaged to provide the county commissioners the opportunities and path forward if there is no transaction. When will we see a group tasked with questioning the very premise of the question? Will this be the charge, part of the charge to the PAG? Additionally, one of the stated reasons for a transaction is to allow the hospital to obtain additional borrowings through bond financing for expansion. What benefit is it to taxpayers and citizens of New Hanover County for the hospital to expand in other counties? Will the organic growth of this county that we expect support the necessary growth for the hospital? And is bond financing the only mechanism for acquired capital? We're not able to use bond financing, yet we've still been able to expand significantly in the last 10 years. There have been multiple references to the need for a $1 billion investment to the healthcare system in our community. As mentioned before by several people, the transparency for this whole process is appallingly light. Very few details have come out illustrating this need, and even fewer details have come out regarding the alternatives or a pro forma analysis that drive these conclusions. When will we see the $1 billion investment need and alternatives outlined in detail as part of this transparent process? One of the issues discussed is the need to address the social determinants of health, and we agree. The question is that the hospital's responsibility or the community's responsibility? Community should be engaged in the best way to handle this need. Some would suggest a tax increase is warranted to address the social need. However, without details and alternative countermeasures being defined, it's possible to engage in the discussion. Mr. Gizdik has repeatedly discussed the change in reimbursement methodologies in healthcare, and he's correct. He's talking about the movement to value versus our current market of volume. We applaud him on this, as Wilmington Health has been working on this for nearly a decade. He's continued to mention the potential for downside risk as a peril and threat to the hospital's ability to remain independent. What strategies has the hospital developed to mitigate this risk? As a point of clarification, the hospital will not be assuming these risks alone, as most of the risk is attributed to the hospital's physician group, not the hospital itself. Wilmington Health plans on doing its part, and if asked, will do more. In less than 3 years, we will be assuming the financial risk for the total cost of care of patients attributed to us. This includes the financial risk of services provided at the hospital, thus alleviating the hospital of any downside risk associated with Wilmington Health patients. The hospital will never be asked to take on the downside risk of patients attributed to Wilmington Health only the patients attributed to its physicians.
And Mr. Bunch, you've come to the end of your time.
Thank you.
The next person to speak is Michael Faulkner.
So Michael Faulkner, 1015 Nutt Street, and I didn't really come here prepared to say anything, but I think it's important to share my story. March 24th, 2013, I was a UNCW college student. I was on my way home, and a car ran a stop sign, hit an older lady who lost control and ended up actually hitting my driver's door and crushed me in between the door and the center console. Then the side airbag came out, twisted my whole back, and then I got whiplash. I've been paralyzed over 12 times since then. It's 7 years. Now, you look at the whole insurance involved, and the guy that ran the stop sign, who's at fault, had no insurance. I had $250,000 underinsured with Allstate. Allstate is an insurance company everyone knows about. Then what happens is, since Allstate's motives is to not pay out in claims, that's how they make a profit, they did everything possible to ensure that I never even made it to arbitration. And they make you go through all your medical records. They go it's a nightmare. And then at the end of it, come find out when you make it to arbitration 5 years later, which most people financially can't even make it that long. Then what happens is the arbitrators are actually the insurance companies have the buying power. So regardless of who hires them, the arbitrators are actually still working in the favor of the insurance companies. So. Ultimately, America needs to be buying up hospitals, not selling hospitals. I know for a fact selling this hospital, whether it's for profit or not for profit, selling it to a private company changes the motives. And I know for a fact my health care is not going to increase if this hospital is sold. So please consider that. Thank you.
We've come to the end of the list of those that have signed up. If there are others in the audience that would like to speak, you're welcome to come to the podium. Please state your name and address for the record. Once again, anyone that's in the audience that has not talked, you're welcome to come to the podium. Please state your name and address for the record. Pretty quiet in here. Again, this is your opportunity to share your thoughts and concerns. Anyone, you're more than welcome to come to the podium. Please state your name and address for the record. Sir, please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Derek Anderson. I live at 1014 Stevenson Drive, Wilmington, North Carolina. I'm a United States Navy veteran. I'm a graduate of the University of North Carolina at Wilmington. I was on the DSS board for 6 years, chairman for two. I'm also was on the hospital committee that studied privatization 22 years ago. Claude O'Shields was the chairman. I was against the sale then, and I'm against it now. I think the whole system has been compromised. There's no transparency. And for the record, I want everybody to know, I do not trust the system. I don't trust what's been going on, and I don't trust some of the things I've been seeing. So I really don't want to say anything except I want the record to show that I think the system is corrupt, and I don't trust it one bit. Thank you.
Once again, if there are others that would like to speak, the podium is open. Please come and state your name and address for the record. We're going to take a 5-minute recess and reconvene in about 5 minutes. We'll now reconvene our meeting. This is a public hearing being recorded and streamed live on our Facebook page for anyone who's unable to attend. Each person will be able to speak for 3 minutes. There's a timekeeper next to the podium who will let you know when you have 1 minute left and then when your time is up. Please be courteous and end your comments at 3 minutes. We ask that you speak about your priorities for healthcare in our community, what is important to you and your family, and what you feel should be required as part of the request for proposals that will be developed. We have members of our Hospital Board of Trustees as well as our Partnership Advisory Group here tonight. The advisory group will be working over the coming months to develop the request for proposals, and the information heard tonight will help inform that work. So that everyone is aware, once the request for proposal has been developed, it will be shared with the public, the trustees, and commissioners. This is anticipated to occur no earlier than December. After the advisory group puts a lot of work into its development, as well as gains an understanding of the full scope of NHRMC's current position and the industry as a whole. We anticipate allowing 60 days for organizations to respond, so it will likely be in February or March before proposals are received. At that time, they'll be shared publicly, and we will convene another public hearing to receive comments on the proposals. It is important to note that while the RFP is out, the Partnership Advisory Group will also be examining the options for maintaining county ownership and will then be able to take that research and evaluate the proposals that come. Now let's get started. I will call several people up at a time based on the sign-up sheet. Please come up in the order you're called to the podium. State your name and your address for the public record. Please talk directly into the microphone, no more than 2 inches away from your face for hard of hearing attendees. And with that, we have had two others to sign up. And then that's all we have signed up at this point. For those that are in the audience that have just come in, you definitely have the opportunity to come to the microphone. If you would like to speak, state your name and address for the record. You have 3 minutes to share your comments. And with that, our first two will be Isla Speller and Laura Dawson.
Mr. Chairman, as they're making their way to the podium, could I be recognized for a moment?
Commissioner White.
In my business in the courthouse, we do a lot in terms of correcting the record. And we've heard a lot of opinions here tonight. We're going to hear more. I look forward to those. But when there are facts that are misstated, I think it's important to point those out. I'm not sure if there are any representatives here from Wilmington Health. If so, please feel free to rebut whatever I'm about to say. And I will disclose that they are my primary care physicians. I hope I get the same excellent care next time I go over there for some medical procedure that I might need. But a couple of things bear pointing out. First, they're for profit. And I would suggest, at least in my own experience, their standard of care is not subpar because of that. Now, that doesn't mean the hospital needs to be for profit, but that's an important point. They do an outstanding job meeting the standard of care, and they make a profit without accepting Medicaid patients. Secondly, one of their physicians is a member of the PAG, Dr. Sandra Hall. She works there. And so to suggest that they're not represented is not factual. I think it's important to point those facts out and correct the record. Thank you.
And again, our first two speakers are Isla Speller and Laura Dawson. If you can please come to the podium.
Good
good evening, everyone. My question is to county commissioners. And what I would like to know, if the county commissioners is part an investor with this privatization of the with the sale of the hospital? Are you a part owner of this plan to sell the hospital? And if so, if this private buyer owns more than one hospital, and out of the seven hospitals this buyer may own, if one of them is not doing financially good or making a profit, where does that leave us as citizens here in New Hanover County as far as another hospital?
And just want to clarify what we're doing here tonight. We're really not answering questions. We're here as a public hearing just to hear comments. There really won't be any back and forth dialogue with the board and the public other than hearing comments and taking notes.
I am vehemently against privatization of selling the hospital.
Hello, my name is Laura Dawson. I have a company here in town, Food Physics and Body Dynamics, LLC. Our company has approved contract with the federal, state, and local government. We do a nutrition, clinical nutrition protocol that can be taught. And what my feelings are about the evolution of healthcare, not only here in our county, but across the United States and globally for that matter, is the significant shift in the type of care that's being provided and required by patients and communities. So I know that a lot of that is leaning on knowledge, exchange of knowledge, and artificial intelligence is being used in some of the larger institutionalized hospitals. We want to make sure that we are keeping in competition by learning about the new discoveries that are being made by those hospitals and organizations within our own community, so we have greater option for expansion rather than contracting. So I'm not necessarily for or against the sale of the hospital. I'm for the expansion or evolution of the services that I believe are essential to be provided to us as county residents. Thank you very much.
And once again, we've now exhausted the list of those that have signed up to speak. For those in the audience, you're more than welcome to come to the podium if you'd like to share comments of up to 3 minutes. Please state your name and address for the record.
Hello, my name is Catherine Cardone. My address is 112 South 8th Street in Wilmington. I'm very concerned because when I've seen over time things become privatized or taken away from the community, you lose control and it becomes a lean, mean thing where the profit has got to be high and the service has to go down and the staff has to get reduced. And I think I've talked to a lot of people during the break in the audience, and a lot of people said, why aren't we having a referendum? Why isn't this on the ballot? This should be not a question for a small group of people, but for everybody, because it services all of us. So I don't understand, and I know you can't answer me, but I think you could hear that a lot of people here want it to be on a referendum. We want to have a vote on it. We don't want it decided for us by a few. By five? How many? 20. So, huh?
Nine?
No, we don't want it for the most part. Everybody I've talked to does not want this. If it's successful and it's working, why would you break it?
Exactly. Once again, the podium is open for those that would like to come in. Share your comments of up to 3 minutes. Please state your name and address for the record.
Mr. Chair, I apologize for leaving, but we're going to speak to the City Council and
give them the same message. Thank you for your time.
Once again, we've exhausted our list of those that have signed up. Anyone in the audience, you're more than welcome to come to the podium to share your comments. You have up to 3 minutes. Please state your name and address for the record. So we've committed to be here until 7 o'clock tonight. We'll probably take a series of breaks to allow others to come in. We know that some people are getting off work and maybe heading here. Want to make sure we have giving everyone ample opportunity to state their opinions. With that being said, I'll say it one more time. Anyone in the audience that would like to speak, you can come to the podium now. You have up to 3 minutes to share your thoughts. Please state your name and address for the record.
Hi, my name's Hannah Gilmore. I'm, oh, sorry. How do I, thank you. My name's Hannah Gilmore. I am an MSW student at UNCW. I'm doing my clinical field work at New Hanover. I apologize, I don't have prepared comments, so I'm sorry if it's a little disorganized, but I don't want to pretend to have any knowledge, expertise, or even shallow understanding of how complex the changing landscape of healthcare is, and I know that there will have to be adjustments made, but I do know that one of the things I feel very fortunate about is being able to do my clinical field work at New Hanover, and if the hospital is to sell, I would really like to see that organization maintain a commitment to hosting students in a supportive environment, and that also means ensuring that employees create a supportive, engaging learning environment and work environment. I know one of the things that I am always looking for is to learn from people who are excited about the work that they do and really committed to their patients, their clients. The other thing that I would really like the hospital to consider in considering the proposals received is the commitment to charity care for uninsured patients. The patients that I've been able to work with at the hospital are largely uninsured, and they benefit greatly from the opportunity to apply for and receive financial assistance from New Hanover. And finally, the commitment to maintaining strong supportive partnerships with community organizations that provide care outside of the hospital to ensure that patients don't readmit and can be successful in all sorts of health issues, mental health, substance abuse, that sort of thing. So, thank you.
And once again, the podium is open for anyone that would like to come and speak. You have up to 3 minutes. Please state your name and address for the record. We will take a 12-minute recess and reconvene. This public hearing is being recorded and streamed live on our Facebook page for anyone who's unable to attend. Each person will be able to speak for up to 3 minutes. There's a timekeeper next to the podium who will let you know when you have 1 minute left and then when your time is up. Please be courteous and end your comments at 3 minutes. We ask that you speak about your priorities for healthcare in our community, what is important to you and your family, and about what you feel should be required as part of the request for proposals that will be developed. We have members of our Hospital Board of Trustees as well as the Partnership Advisory Group here tonight. The advisory group will be working over the coming months to develop the request for proposals, and the information heard tonight will help inform that work. So that everyone is aware, once a request for proposal has been developed, it will be shared with the public, the trustees, and the commissioners. This is anticipated to occur no earlier than December, after the advisory group puts a lot of work into its development, as well as gains an understanding of the full scope of NHRMC's current position and the industry as a whole. We anticipate allowing 60 days for organizations to respond, so we'll likely be in February or March before proposals are received. At that time, they will be shared publicly, and we will convene another public hearing to receive comments on the proposals. It is important to note that while the RFP is out, the Partnership Advisory Group will also be examining the options for maintaining county ownership and will then be able to take that research and evaluate the proposals that come. Now let's get started. I will call several people up at a time based on the sign-up sheet. Please come up in the order you're called to the podium. State your name and address for the public record. Please talk directly into the microphone, no more than 2 inches away from your face, for our hard of hearing attendees. And we have two additional people that signed up. For those in the audience that may want to speak, if you've not signed up, you're more than welcome to come to the podium, state your name and address for the record, and you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak. Right now we have two individuals, John Godwin and Al Sharp. If you can make your way to the podium, please state your name and address for the record.
This is it. Okay. My name is John Godwin, and I thank you for the opportunity to address the esteemed members of this board. I was born in this city and grew up here, went to school here, and received my PhD in history in 1994 at the University of South Carolina. And I wrote a book about Wilmington, interviewed people like Herb McKim, Hubert Eaton, T.C. Gervais. They were very active in the early movement in the 50s and 60s to construct New Hanover Memorial Hospital. And I know how concerned they were about where this city was going in 1960, when the Atlantic Coastline Railroad was withdrawing, and so many people in the business community in Wilmington thought, this city is just going to dry up and blow away because business is leaving. What are we going to do? And they decided to construct a new hospital, a first-class one. And they had a problem they had to solve. They had to bring blacks and whites together. African Americans had an old hospital, community hospital, built by the New Deal, a public hospital, and African Americans didn't want to give it up. So they had to work it out. They did. They built New Hanover Memorial Hospital through a bond issue, a public hospital, a public institution paid for and financed through the tax dollars. Well, what are we up against here? We're up against conservatism, Southern style. It's old. It's been around for a long time, and it's had its way in Wilmington. It's worked its way in the history of this city for a long time. The railroads here were financed through public bond issues, paid for by the people of this area, and then they sold them out to the big corporations. Cotton mills, same story. And all across the South, where the mind of the South reigned and racial fear has been so rampant, lending itself to conservative domination, so often it was the Southern kids, white and black, who got the worst health care, worst schools, worst treatment, and who would really stand up for their interests. So often it just wasn't there, and they suffered, okay? Diseases that were endemic, rickets, hookworm, pellagra, that were often related to nutrition. And then the New Deal came along. I'm not trying to give you a whole history lesson.
Mr. Godwin, your time has expired.
Oh, I don't get to finish?
Your time has expired. Thank you, sir.
Sorry.
Al Sharp.
Hi, my name's Al Sharp. I live at 613 Chestnut Street. As background, I'm a retired county manager. I'm retired executive director of Charlotte Mecklenburg Council of Government. I sat on a hospital board for 8 years. I know how painful the process is when a community feels that it's losing one of its assets. About 4 years ago, we ran a program here to look at issues and how the region could move forward. There were three key items that came out of the research. One, both people who live here and people who come here are very proud of their community. They're proud of UNCW because of the richness that it brings to the community. They're proud of the medical facilities that are here. So many of the retirees who have been come here have come here because their children want to know that there is a reliable, managed system to provide health care. And the third issue was the quality of life. And one of the key components of the quality of life was trust. The citizens here and in the other two counties that we researched believed fundamentally that their local governments were responsible, intelligent, and made good decisions, both the cities and the counties. So what I am really asking is, at this time, why are we looking at the possible disillusionment of one of our main props of the community? And how are we going to effectively know that it is in the best interest of the community in terms of the quality of care, major employment, and a sustainable economic pattern? So I appreciate the opportunity of speaking. I hope we would not rush into a decision that we would regret. There's a deep abiding conviction here in the community that the health system is our system. We need to be served by it, and we need to protect it. I'm trusting that the county board and the advisory committee will look at every option before they make a decision. Thank you for your time.
Next is Allie Reed. You can come and state your name and address for the record, please.
Good evening. Allie Reed, 219 Chamber Street. That's in Leland. I was actually sitting on the couch streaming this live, and I just had a crazy day. I was going to come, which is why I'm so nervous, and then crazy day, and I just really felt like I needed to come here and say that as a New Hanover Regional employee, I am so thankful to you guys. I have felt that you guys have been very transparent, and I'm also a student, so I've been studying healthcare, and all of the reasons make sense to me, and I just hope that everybody can go into it with an open mind and really explore why we're doing this. It makes sense. And we are part of so many great initiatives. I'm on a housing team. And if we had more resources, we could really provide exceptional care that even more better than we're already doing. I really, truly believe that. And I have full faith in our leadership. And I'm not worried. And you guys, I just want to thank you guys. Thank you.
And that's the end of the list of those that have signed up to speak at this moment. For those that are in the audience that would like to speak, you're more than welcome to come to the podium. You'll have up to 3 minutes to share your comments. Just please state your name and address for the record. Once again, anyone in the audience, you're more than welcome to come to the podium. You have up to 3 minutes to speak. Just please state your name and address for the record. Our goal is to make sure that any citizen that wants to speak at this public hearing has the opportunity. I think we'll have one more public hearing later in the process. Once again, anyone that's in the audience that would like to speak, you have up to 3 minutes. Please come to the podium and state your name and address for the record. With that being said, we will take a 15-minute recess and we'll reconvene at 6:30. Only one time, sir. Thank you. We'll reconvene at 6:30. At this time, we've had no additional people to sign up to speak. For those that are in the audience, you're more than welcome to come to the podium. You have up to 3 minutes to share your thoughts and concerns. You will state your name and address for the record, please. But once again, at this time, we've had no one from the audience to sign up to speak. Only allowed to speak once. Is there anyone that would like to come to the podium and share your comments and thoughts and concerns? We have committed to being here until 7 o'clock, and we're gonna do just that. Wanna make sure that anyone that does come between now and 7 will have the opportunity to share their thoughts and concerns. Once again, is there anyone in the audience that would like to come and share your thoughts? If so, please come to the podium. You can state your name and address for the record. And this is our attempt to make sure that there is complete transparency in the process. I want to give every citizen the opportunity to share their concerns. For those that are watching on Facebook and watching live, I truly believe that it's the responsibility of citizens to be engaged in your government and not just sit back. And with that being said, we'll take a 10-minute recess. We'll reconvene at 5 till the hour. And if there's someone that signs up to speak then, we'll hear those individuals. If not, we will indeed close our meeting. Thank you. We'll now reconvene our meeting for the last 3 minutes. We've had no one additional to sign up to speak at our public hearing. If there's anyone in the audience that would like to speak, you're more than welcome to come to the microphone. Please state your name and address for the record. You'll be given 3 minutes to speak. Once again, if there's anyone here who's not spoken, that would like to come to the microphone, you will have up to 3 minutes to share your thoughts and concerns. And with no one coming forward, we want to thank you for your time tonight, for all those that have participated either online or in person. We'll convene another public hearing in the future as our PAG group continues their work. Thank you once again for being here. Be safe on your way home. Good night. Meeting adjourned.